Thank you. Yes, absolutely. So, I mean, as you can see, there's a lot to unravel and all sorts of things come up. So first of all, I want to thank you for sharing how this landed with you, because that's what makes Torata come to life. There are no books we can go to yet. We're working on things, but not yet. It's written now. It's not imagining a world in another time. The other thing is, there really is, we didn't touch, there's two things that we didn't touch upon. One is the blessing. What did it feel like to hear the fruit of the womb? That kind of language, because now we have a lineage of mothers and daughters, so womb, birthing womb, birthing womb. Just something to think about. And this chapter ends with another succession. So the blessing that Emrama is receiving is manifest right at the end of the chapter. Something to think about. And all these names mean something. So actually there is, we included the interpretation of the names. So you can see them as qualities that are, instead of think of them as people, think of them as kind of qualities that are moving through these changes. And that might open another reading of the story. So to wrap it up, let's do the closing prayer. And also, the other thing that I included here is a gendered neutral version of the story. That's fine. That taught me, actually, when I did that, it was the first time that I noticed, really, it really brought up for me the difference between Elohim and Teova as two distinct states. Elohim and Teova, goddess and Teova. That's when I did that, that's when it lifted up for me. As something that moves through the story in a particular way. But let's close with the closing.
Actually, I see that the last page did not make it into the packet.
Oh, can you read it? Yes, absolutely.
Would you like me to give it to you?
No, you can go ahead. Yeah, may we succeed.
And that study will strengthen us in us a love of life, a love of charity to spread blessing in the world. And let us say she is a tree of life to those who grasp her, and whoever holds onto her is joyous.
Amen. Thank you. This I can turn off, right?
Yeah,
I think it's right here somewhere.
Poem is called Coming Up on September. It's written by Marge Piercy. Somebody has to turn off a computer where there is a 40-second delay on the live stream, which I can hear in somewhere. Is there a computer open? Is it coming from there? The Bluetooth speaker is still playing us on a 40-second delay in a room. This is like some really twisted version of WandaVision or something. Thank you, Rebecca. And sorry for those of you who had to hear me say that out loud here. Very a weird experience. I'm sure there's something meaningful there in preparations for high holidays of having to watch our actions on a 40-second delay and deal with the implications of it when you can't change it. Right? Did I do that? Okay. This poem is still called Coming Up on September by Marge Piercy. White butterflies with single black finger paint eyes on their wings dart and settle, eddy and mate over the green tangle of vines in Labor Day morning steam. The year grinds into ripeness and rot, grapes darkening, pears yellowing, the first Virginia creeper twinning crimson, the grasses dry straw to burn. The new year rises, beckoning across the umbrellas on the sand, I begin to reconsider my life. What is the yield of my impatience? What is the fruit of my resolve? I turn from my frantic white dance over the jungle of productivity, and slowly a nigoon slides, cold water down my throat. I rest on a leaf spotted red. Now is the time to let the mind search backwards, like the raven loosed to see what can feed us. Now the time to cast the mind forward, to chart an aerial map of the months. The new year is a great door that stands across the evening, and Yom Kippur is the second door. Between them are song and silence, stone and clay pot to be filled from within myself. I will find there both ripeness and rot, what I have done and undone, what I must let go with the waning days, and what I must take in. With the last tomatoes, we harvest the fruit of our lives.
Time to repair what has been broken. Let us all we never can change all the times we have mistaken. Let us all forgive. Let us all be forgiven. Let us try to rebuild all the trust we have forsaken. Let us all forgive. Let us all be forgiven. Slach lanu, mechalanu, kaper, kaper lanu. Slach lanu, mechalanu, kaper, kaper lanu.
Notice the river at break of dawn, a breed of streams, creeks, and brooks, a dance of insects near the shore. Notice how brackish, where the river meets the sea, how with grace the river hugs the shore, fierce in its rising, fiercer when it falls. Notice it all, how it bends, how it tells the time of year, and how smooth the boulders are that guide its course. Notice the Holy One in blessing and in beauty, in acts of repair, in the unearthing of truth, in eyes that meet in the tumult of change, in words of forgiveness, in the bridges we build to those we hurt, in the flow of a year, in the course of a journey, in rising and falling, in the bend of a river, in the hand we hold out to those who hurt us, in the life we are living, in blessing and in beauty.
Lerea ha kamocha, Lerea ha kamocha.
in a moment, we will together change our Torah covers from their regular beautiful multicolored covers to the special white ones. And we'll do that here, we'll do that here, so everyone can participate. I was thinking about changing the Torah covers today as I was standing at the Ark with our Benot Mitzvah this morning. And I always talk with them up there about sort of what's inside and what's outside of the Torah, right? That the Torah scrolls that we sort of gift them when they become adults are the same scrolls that generations before us have read and that, God willing, generations after us will continue to read. And part of what is different is how it looks, literally what the cover looks like on the outside of the Torah scroll. And so I was thinking about changing our covers this evening and how it really is just a change of a cover, right? I mean, the Torah, at least the Torah we know is still the Torah, whether the cover is red or blue or white. And obviously, you know, this is all about also our own preparation for the High Holy Days. And yet, how much it matters to go through the ritual of changing the covers, right? That there's something about the way we experience the scroll and the learning when we see it in that white, although imperfect and not purely white, that's an invitation to us not to feel like we have to magically be different, you know, when the new year starts or when we get to Yom Kippur or Rosh Hashanah, right? The scrolls are the same, but it's the way maybe we interact with them and the way we are open to what the Torah opens up before us, that changes, right? It's not magic. It's work. It's holy work. But it's all the same scroll. And yet, the ritual matters. And that's the sort of back and forth of this moment of changing covers. This piece I'm going to offer first that is really a lovely piece. It's called The Elders. It's written by Lisa Rauschwerger. And then I will invite us to stand, and it's like kind of sweet, clumsy, holy work of changing Torah covers. We'll assemble ourselves. We'll take all the Torahs out of the Ark. We have the white ones here. They spell Ha'emet in Hebrew. In the white ones, I mean, in the colorful ones, the back says Pardes, and these say Ha'emet, which means the truth. And so we will together try to change our scrolls, and maybe without talking, right? We'll sort of let the moment of the ritual be what carries us, and there'll be music to help sort of move us through that. And once we have finished changing the scrolls, we'll return them to their aron, and we will have some time for anybody who wishes to just take a moment or a breath at the Ark. We'll offer our first Avinu Malkeinu of the season formally and a shofar blast, and head off into the week that awaits for us. So again, this piece is called The Elders, written by Lisa Rauschwerger. We rise now to honor them, our elders from whom we have learned stories and lessons, with whom we have studied and worshiped and celebrated the passages of life and time, our elders who have taught us goodness, honesty, and the sanctity of life, whose mantles are woven with threads of memory, embroidered with silver and gold, majestic folds of silk and velvet, and royal hues befitting their rank, as brilliant as the sun. We rise now to honor them as they put aside these everyday mantles of splendor and don their sacred garments, the vestments of purity and holiness, befitting the days of awe so soon approaching. Each in its turn is fitted with wimple, mantle, and crowns, each more stunning than the last, majestic folds of velvet and silk to clothe the holy words, a canvas of purest white as brilliant as the moon. The holy season has now begun, and the elders in their yontif clothes stand proud and tall before us, beacons of wisdom and light, reminders of the holiness we seek on this new day in Elul. So I just invite you to rise quietly and make your way to the front. I think maybe we'll do it here. So if six people who are feeling sturdy would love to come take Torahs first, we will sort of manipulate the covers and scrolls from our places here, and then we'll return them to the ark. The letters are all a little mixed up right now, but that seems somehow appropriate. You'll just trust me that if we're standing in the right order, they spell Ha'emet, which means the truth. And as we put the Torahs back in the Ark in their covers for the next few weeks, really till we will change them back at Simchat Torah, when we end and start again, just invite us to reflect on what our truths are. right? What is the truth we're seeking that we're hanging on to that we feel like is maybe blind faith that is hurting other people, the truths that root us and center us, the things that become truths because we study them or we discover them in a new way, whatever they are, right? They are many because we are holding them. And these are our moments to sort of reflect and to find our truths this way. Like to take a moment at the arc, whatever pace you wish. That is what this time is for.
Avinu, Malkeinu, Choneinu, Vaneinu, Ki ein banu ma'asim. Aseh imanu, tzedako v'chesed, ve'hoshim.
Walk with me into the woods, leave the edge of the forest behind. Come deep into the green until the shafts of sunlight are lost. Feel the stillness of the center. Walk with me to the top of the hill, leave the broad path behind, up, up beyond where the trees grow. Hear the quiet of the heights. Walk me into this new year, into its demands, into its joys, into the clamor of its unfolding. Walk alone, each of us, on our own right path, with the echoes of the blasts of the shofar, with the stillness of the center, with the help of our God.
Tikiya.
Shavua Tov.